Good morning, new creation.
Good morning.
You know, it is said that few things are permanent except change. Last year, for this program, you will recall that we were seated outside. And today we are comfortably seated inside our sanctuary. Last year, the Women's Day program was brought to you by the New Creation United Methodist Women. Today, it is brought to you by the New Creation United Women in Faith. Our name has changed. Our commitment, however, to service and mission is strengthened. And we look forward to an engaging and enjoyable celebration of Women's Day. I'm asking that you take a look at the flyer that was distributed to everyone to look at and have an idea of the work that we have engaged in over this past year. We have felt that the needs were there, our ability to address many of those needs were within our power, and we have enjoyed doing the work of Jesus Christ. So join with us as we celebrate inside and with a new name, Women's Day at New Creation.
Good morning.
Here are our announcements for today. Children's Church has resumed. This afternoon, the adult Sunday school will meet via Zoom, as will the study you gotta ask for the young adults. Now, this study is a church-wide study that's being done in groups, and the young adults are doing theirs this afternoon. On Wednesday, our noon Bible study will focus on the book You Gotta Ask, and then we will have a Wednesday evening study that will focus on the same book. We urge you all to be a part of one of these groups. The Lay Nominations Committee will meet on Thursday via Zoom at 6:30. The Finance Committee will meet on Tuesday, September 20th at 6:30. The flowers on the altar this morning are being given in loving memory of Miss LaBertha Bowie by her daughter and son, Pat and Ricky McGee. Pastor Appreciation Day will be on October 2nd. There will be a basket available for you to bring any token or gift that you have for the pastor. And we want to all show her our appreciation for what she means to us here at New Creation. This is National Hispanic Heritage Month, from September 15th to October 15th. And we will be celebrating during this month. I spoke to you about the You Gotta Ask study. Prayers are being requested for LaWanda Foster, for our nation and our world, for our college students who are headed back, and our children, the teachers and administrators. We also send prayers and condolences to Dominique and Sashir Sloan. Dominique lost his mother this week, and Sashir lost an uncle. continued prayers. Please keep those who have been on our prayer list in your prayers. Birthdays this week: Suzanne Green, September 18th. Brandy Ketisak, September 23rd. Timothy Arthur, September 21. Armani Jones, September 22nd. And Carolyn Black, September 23rd. The anniversary today of Myra and Randy Griffin, we celebrate with them today.
Cry out to the Lord, for God hears our pleas. Place your trust in the Lord, whose compassion comes speedily to greet us. Come, worship the one who hears our pleas. We will enter God's gates with hope and gladness. And our opening prayer: Almighty God, you are the God of our salvation, for in you alone do we find our strength to revive our souls. In you alone do we find nourishment to meet the needs for this journey. Come speedily to us once more, that we may see your glory and know where our true help lies. Amen.
You may be seated. We pause now for a moment to remember the deceased members of our unit. We honor them for their faithfulness, their leadership and commitment to the work of the United Women in Faith. And we stand on their shoulders as we seek to improve the lives of women, children, and youth in our world. Let us remember Shirley Barrow, Luberta Bowie, Essie Curry, Pauline Curtis, Alda Davis, Ophelia Ruth Davis, Ophelia Grandy, Charlotte Hackett, Mary Hall, Pauline Johnson, Dorothy Phelps Jones, Flory McLaughlin, Margaret Minor, Marie Moffett, Lucille Palmer, Clara Perry, Clara Sampson, Thomasina Shaw, Marion Thomas, Minerva Wagstaff, Louise Weeks, and Ann Wilson. We give thanks to God for their service. We also, this morning, would like to announce who the unit has chosen for candle burning. Candle burning is offered as a channel of undesignated missional giving. Funds are donated in honor of, as well as in memory of, loved ones, members of the church family or community. Each local unit chooses a person to be honored, sending donations to the district. And the collective giving from our district goes toward mission locally and around the world. This year, our unit lights the candle in honor of our pastor, Reverend Veronica Livingston, for her pastoral leadership, love, and steadfast support of New Creation United Methodist Church. Thank you. We have a special recognition this morning. In every church, there are Marys and there are Marthas. Actually, in a small church, some at times can always identify with both the busy, resourceful Martha, preparing and serving, working to make sure all is ready, a little anxious that there are not enough worker bees to get things done, as well as the devoted Mary, focusing on Jesus and spending time in his presence, sitting at his feet, immersing ourselves in and responding to his words. Today, the United Women of Faith gives special recognition to one of our members who works like Martha, the first to volunteer to help with any task, big or small, as long as she can lead from behind. She can be counted on to come early, leave late, set up, take down, whatever the task. She is there with no prodding. But most appropriately, she is a true Mary. No matter how busy, she puts Jesus first in everything. She is a true disciple of Christ and a role model for us all. Please join as we give special recognition to Ms. Mary Jones. She's out doing Martha things.
Each year, it is our pleasure to recognize one of the many outstanding women here at New Creation United Methodist Church. Now, this year, our selection is a woman who is not really an A. She's not really a B person. She's definitely a C person. Yeah, she's a C person. She's a C person because she cares for this church and this community. She's a C person because she's committed to realizing the goal of this church. And she's a C person because she is committed to active participation and work in the church. She's also a C person because she has the courage to demand excellence and will take nothing less. Now, as she moves through these activities, she may be a person who is the member of a group. So she's a follower, which she does quite well. Or she may be someone who has asked others to work with her, and she is a leader in that group, which she also does quite well. So in thinking about who follows or who really fills this description, we concluded that the challenges of this year, and they have been many, we have Zoomed ourselves to death in United Women of Faith. We concluded that we clearly place the honor as New Creation, United Women in Faith, Woman of the Year, on Dr. Bernice Duffy Johnson. Done something that people seldom do to Bernice. We've surprised her. This plaque reads, Woman of the Year Award presented to Bernice Duffy Johnson in recognition of outstanding dedication and commitment to the United Women in Faith of New Creation and invaluable service and support in the life of the church and the community.
Thank you very much.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Buenos dias. Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, so that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. The first lesson comes to us from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 8, verses 18 through chapter 9, verse 1. I'll be reading in Spanish. You can follow along in English and practice your Spanish as well. Jeremías, capítulo 8, versículos 18 hasta capítulo 9, versículo 1. Mi dolor no tiene remedio, mi corazón desfallece. Los ayes de mi pueblo se oyen por todo el país. Ya no está el Señor en Sion, ya no está allí su rey. Y el Señor responde, ¿por qué me ofendieron adorando los ídolos, a dioses inútiles y extraños? Pasó el verano, se acabó la cosecha y no ha habido salvación para nosotros. Sufro con el sufrimiento de mi pueblo. La tristeza y el terror se han apoderado de mí. ¿No habrá algún remedio en Galad? ¿No habrá allí nadie que lo cure? ¿Por qué no puede sanar mi pueblo? Ojalá fueran mis ojos como un manantial, como un torrente de lágrimas, para llorar día y noche por los muertos de mi pueblo. La palabra de Dios para el pueblo de Dios. Gracias a Dios.
Good morning. I'll be reading the second lesson this morning. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. I'll be reading Luke chapter 16, verses 1 through 13 in English. Excuse me. Then Jesus said to the disciples, there was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was squandering his property. So he summoned him and said to him, what is this that I hear about you? Give me an accounting of your management, because you cannot be my manager any longer. Then the manager said to himself, what will I do now that my master has taken the position away from me? I am not strong enough to dig, and I am ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do so that when I am dismissed as manager, people may welcome me into their homes. So summoning his master's debtors one by one, he asked the first, how much do you owe my master? He answered, 100 jugs of olive oil. He said to him, take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 50. Then he asked another, how much do you owe? He replied, 100 containers of wheat. He said to him, take your bill and make it 80. And his master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly, for the children of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than are the children of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of dishonest wealth, so that when it is gone, they may welcome you into eternal homes. Whoever is faithful in very little is faithful also in much, and whoever is dishonest in a very little is dishonest also in much. If then you have not been faithful with the dishonest wealth, who will entrust to you the true riches? And if you have not been faithful with what belongs to another, who will give you what is your own? No slave can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. The word of God for us, the people of God.
It is my distinct pleasure and honor to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Kathleen Colon Emmerich. Medical education, research, and practice is focused on assisting seniors to live with dignity and remain healthy and active as they progress on life's path. Dr. Colon Emmerich also educates the senior's family to the common problems associated with aging. To this end, Dr. Colon Emmerich is a professor of medicine, associate dean for the research mentoring at Duke University, a senior fellow for the Duke Center for Aging and Human Development, and the assistant director of the Geriatric Research Education and Clinical Center at Durham VA Medical Center. When assisting a senior, Dr. Kathleen rallies a team of professionals that includes a social worker, geriatric nurse specialist, and a geriatric psychiatrist in order to ensure that the well-being of the whole person is being addressed and that she has a clear understanding of the patient's goals for this chapter of their life. Dr. Kathleen Colleen Emmerich has secured 35 grants, written 174 academic articles, and submitted 24 conference papers to further the science and healthy living options for the seniors in her practice and the senior population at large. Dr. Kathleen Emmerich, Colleen Emmerich, is also the wife of Edgardo Colleen Emmerich, Dean of Duke Divinity School, mother of two grown wonderful sons, an exceptional vocalist, and a longstanding member of New Creation United Methodist Church. Her contributions to our congregation and our community are truly a blessing. And now I present Dr. Kathleen Colleen Emmerich.
Thank you so much, Fran. Please pray with me. Dear Lord, I am unworthy to stand here today, but you are the great physician who transformed the lives of bent and broken women with a touch of your garment. Grant that my words will be acceptable in your sight and healing to your people. Amen. So it's traditional in my field to start out a talk with a little bit of statistics, some epidemiology of whatever topic you're going to be covering today. So here goes. The World Health Organization estimates that there's been a 25% increase in major depression and anxiety disorders since the start of COVID. Suicide attempts among adolescents increased by nearly one-third in that same time period. The number of drug overdoses among U.S. adults has hit records 3 years running. In other words, we are walking in a weeping world. But you didn't need these statistics to tell you that. First slide, please, Lester. The images and the stories of grief are everywhere. We grieve for 6.5 million loved ones lost to COVID. Next slide. The continuing unbearable cost of racism in our country. Next slide. War and violence rocking our world. Next slide. Social injustice. Next slide. And natural disasters that always seem to impact the most vulnerable among us. And let's be honest, that's usually women, children, and older adults, isn't it? As a physician, I've lost count of how many patients and families and colleagues have asked me for advice on how to manage the mental health consequences of this difficult time we're living in. And I give the answers you would expect. I advise more exercise, finding positive ways to socialize with each other, limiting your exposure to news and social media, writing down three good things to happen to you every night before bed. And occasionally, I'll even recommend medication for crippling anxiety or depression that's impacting your quality of life. But frankly, all of that advice feels absolutely inadequate for what we have been facing together these last 3 years. I mean, really, is writing down three good things going to help any of the women whose pictures you just saw? So how do we as Christians respond to and walk through a weeping world without succumbing to despair? How should we act when it feels like everything is coming crashing down around us? These are the questions that were going through my mind as I read the lectionary readings today in preparation for speaking. And to be honest, it felt like God was giving me answers in every single text. I actually don't know who it was back in the third century who decided which readings from the Old and New Testament and the Gospels should go together on a particular Sunday, but I think that they were pretty brilliant because usually the combination of these disparate texts gives a more complete picture, more complete answers to the questions we're facing than any one alone. So what we're going to do today is we're going to walk through the lectionary readings together to find out how we can walk through a weeping world together as Christians. This week, we start with an Old Testament passage from Jeremiah, also known as the Weeping Prophet, whose words seem like they could have been written in 2022 rather than in 650 BC. My heart is sick. For the hurt of my people I mourn. Why has the health of my people not been restored? Does this sound familiar? Who's here said some of these words over the last few years? I know I certainly have. Clearly, there was plenty of weeping in the Bible, too. And again, I think women were probably overrepresented there. Can you name some examples? Should warn you that also in my field, it's traditional to ask for responses and conversation from the group. Give me some examples of weeping in the Bible. Call them out.
Jesus,
thank you, Lester. Who else?
Rachel.
I'm an educator, I can wait. Mary. Ruth. Esther, absolutely, these are all great examples. Jeremiah's words remind us that there's really nothing new under the sun. We join grieving people across the ages. And yet, just a few chapters later, our weeping prophet actually changes his tune. Next slide. He tells us that God will turn our mourning into gladness and bring us comfort and joy instead of sadness. In other words, the God of Israel is faithful to his people in times of trial. So let's keep looking at our lectionary readings to find advice on how people of faith should respond in those times. Next slide. So the other Old Testament readings that we didn't actually read together this morning are Psalm 79 and Amos 8. And they force us to ask ourselves why the world is weeping. Does God have cause to be angry with us? How have we trampled on the needy, brought ruin to the land? What wounds have our ancestors made that we have not yet healed? So as I read these passages, things that were running through my mind were the stories from the 1619 Project that vividly illustrate how our nation's roots in slavery have led to the shameful inequities we still face today. How the damage to the environment that I help inflict every day because I won't change the way I shop or eat or travel. How our government tried to build a wall to keep immigrants and refugees who need our help out of this country. And how we are allowing disagreements about who belongs and doesn't belong in our church family to tear our denomination apart. So I want some examples from you. What examples come to your mind as you read these passages? What have we done to cause our world to weep?
Being
consumeristic. What else?
Less than migrants. Immigrants.
Not welcoming immigrants. Others.
Failing to feed the poor.
Failing to feed the poor, even those in our own community.
Good.
Being too patriarchal. Excellent.
Not caring for our children.
Not caring for our children.
Not caring for those who are incarcerated.
Not caring for the incarcerated. Great. So what I took away from these passages is that Christians walking in a weeping world need to acknowledge that how our own sin has committed to that so that we can start repairing some of the damage we have caused. In other words, this is God's version of what our mothers always tell us. You made the mess. You clean it up, correct. So with that reminder, let's turn to today's gospel reading. Next slide. This is the parable of the dishonest steward. And honestly, this one has always been a head-scratcher for me. It really sounds like it should come out of the art of the deal rather than the gospel of Jesus Christ, right? So the steward has been caught in wrongdoing. His world is falling apart. He's about to be fired and homeless and having to beg for his food. So he commits fraud in order to get into the good graces of his master's debtors so that he can get favors from them later. And so what does his master think about all this? He praises him, right? Surely Jesus isn't encouraging us to commit dishonest, unethical business practices, right? Honestly, I've never understood the point of this parable. So I did what most of us lay people do when we don't understand a Bible passage.
Google.
I Googled it. Sorry, Edgardo, right? And there seem to be two main interpretations that scholars have had for the meaning of this parable. The first one is to use our worldly gifts to help others find the kingdom of heaven. Use our worldly gifts to help others find the kingdom of heaven. All right, that seems like a good thing for Christians to do when things are going badly in the world. But since we can only get so far with the example of our dishonest steward, and this is Women's Sunday after all, let's take a look at a holy woman who lived into that message to see what we can learn from her example. Next slide. Catherine Drexel was born into high society in Philadelphia in 1858, and she became a wealthy heiress in her 20s. When she heard that the U.S. government had stopped all financial backing for schools serving Native American children, Catherine decided to travel to Italy to take up the matter with the Pope. I love a take charge kind of woman. And this is how she described that meeting. "Kneeling at his feet, my girlish fancy thought that surely God's vicar would not refuse me, so I pleaded missionary priests for Bishop O'Connor's Indians. To my astonishment, His Holiness responded, 'Why not, my child? Become yourself a missionary.'" So Catherine Drexel went on to found a religious order dedicated to educating Native American and Black children, and she donated her entire estate to the equivalent of $400 million today. As you might imagine, she met with fierce opposition, especially here in the South, which she, quote, "serenely ignored." Love that. She purchased land, she built schools, she sent donations to other struggling schools to keep them afloat, again, including some right here in North Carolina. St. Catherine founded Xavier University to address the critical shortage of Black teachers in the U.S. and sent her own nuns to train there as well. So not only was Xavier the only Black Catholic university in the country, it had an integrated faculty and it had white sisters studying beside Black students at a time when all Southern classrooms were strictly segregated. I particularly like this description from one scholar, that Catherine's theology of education was the spirit of the Eucharist, the total gift of self. So the story of St. Catherine Drexel and the Stuart show us another good way for Christians to behave when the world is on falling apart, to use our worldly gifts, both financial and personal, to help others find the kingdom of heaven. Now, the second main interpretation of the parable of the unjust steward that Google provided for me was very different. It goes like this, that a wise person sees the end approaching and makes an intelligent plan. They take what they know about their master and act in a way that accords with their master's priorities. Now, this one's a little trickier to understand, so let's look at a second holy woman to see who might serve as an example for us here. Edith Stein was born into a German Jewish family, but converted to Christianity and became a Carmelite nun in 1933. She worked as a nurse in World War I and subsequently got her doctorate in philosophy. Dr. Stein was a fierce advocate for women's rights and equal access to education, particularly at the university level. So many of us here today owe a debt of gratitude to her for being a trailblazer. When World War II broke out, she was moved to a convent in the Netherlands to keep her safe in light of her Jewish heritage. But when the Dutch Bishops' Conference had a public statement read in all churches condemning Nazi racism, all Jewish converts who had previously been spared were rounded up and sent to concentration camps in retaliation. Edith's faith and calm service to her fellow prisoners in concentration camps so impressed a Dutch official there that he actually offered her an escape strategy. Her response? "If somebody intervened at this point and took away my chance to share in the fate of my brothers and sisters, that would be utter annihilation." On August 9th, Edith Stein and nearly 1,000 others were killed in a gas chamber in Auschwitz, 1942. So Edith Stein shows us another way to walk in a weeping world. When we are facing what seems to be calamity, we need to focus on what our master expects from us: faith, solidarity with the persecuted, hope in the world to come. And like Edith Stein, we will find our master's favor. Finally, let's turn to our New Testament lectionary reading for our last set of instructions. First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgivings be made for everyone, for kings and all who are in high positions, so that we might lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and dignity. Now, it shouldn't be surprising to anybody here that prayer and thanksgiving are listed as key instructions for Christians wanting a peaceful and godly life. But what did surprise me and frankly cause me some chagrin is the particular instruction here to pray and give thanks for leaders and people in authority. So my family can attest that while I've had many choice words over the last few years for our leaders on both sides of the aisle, very few of them could be characterized as either thanksgiving or supplication, right? But prayer is powerful, and a final holy women, next slide, can help remind us of this. This is St. Monica, whose perseverance in prayer for her capricious and wayward son is credited with his ultimate conversion and rise to leadership. You might have heard of this fellow. He became St. Augustine, an important theologian and doctor of the church. So thanksgiving and intercession for those close to us as well as those in power promotes peace in a weeping world. Now at this point in the lectionary, I'm feeling a little bit overwhelmed. Anybody else feeling kind of exhausted here? Yep. All of this good advice on handling calamity from our readings is great, but it seems exhausting and impossible for anybody except perhaps a few extraordinary saints. How are we to manage all of this when we are already feeling so beaten down by the world around us? Once again, our brilliant lectionary reading designers have come to the rescue because our readings today end with the most important reminder of all. Let's look at this, the end of this passage. This is right and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires everyone to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. This is really amazing news. God wants our weeping to end. Despite that we trample on the poor and pollute the earth, despite the sins of our ancestors that we continue to perpetuate, despite our unethical business practices, despite our failure to live up to the good examples he gives us, God wants to be reconciled to us. And even better, he has provided a way for that to happen. For there is one God, there is also one mediator between God and humankind, Christ Jesus, himself human, who gave himself as a ransom for all. This was attested at the right time. So not only did God provide someone to intervene on our behalf, he gave us a human mediator who, just like us, wept for a world in pain, as Lester reminded us. A human who gave himself as a ransom for all of us at the right time, so that, last slide, every tear will be wiped from their eyes, there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. So, how should we Christians walk in this weeping world? Our lectionary today reminds us that we need to confess that we have caused much of the weeping and start cleaning up our mess. That we need to use our gifts to help others find the kingdom of heaven. That we need to always act in ways that align with our master's goals. And that we need to pray and give thanks for those in power. And finally, we should never forget that God both desires and has provided the means for washing our tears away. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen. Amen. To God be the glory. Thank God for the message on this morning, for being reminded that this is a weeping world, but God has given us the tools to do what we can to make things better. So thank you for that word this morning. We're going to ask the praise team if they would come and sing before we affirm our faith.
Good word. Thank you.
are a little behind in terms of doing this, but we've received a wonderful message.
Amen.
A thoughtful message that with many takeaways and with the idea that perhaps we may want to hear more.
Let us stand and affirm our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. Now it is time for our prayer and our joys and concerns, should you have those.
It's been a wonderful Women's Day. We've heard wonderful things, and we've seen people lifted and blessed for their work and service. Psalm 121, 1 and 2, you can say it with me. I will lift up my eyes unto the hills. From whence cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God of comfort, who meets us in whatever we face, help us to be of good cheer, whether things are going great or whether we're in a crisis of the moment. We call it a crisis of the moment because in you and by our faith, we know that troubles don't last always. We thank you for your wonderful healing power, for your love, your grace, and mercy, and our salvation through Christ Jesus. Now, merciful God, you have heard the situations of your children, whether in joy, praise, thanksgiving, or in grief, sorrow, worry, or loss. You know the concerns that have not been spoken, perhaps concerns even for our own personal health and well-being. We ask that you hear our pleas, O Lord, incline thy ear to us. Grant us your blessings and peace according to your will. Lord God, be with us, guide us, and lead us in the way you'd have us to go and to be. Keep us encouraged to do your will as children of God. And God, keep us encouraged to do more, to love you more, to study your word more, to feed more people, to clothe more people, to be concerned with the immigrants, to be concerned and to do what we can for the homeless. You know we have many needs and we need to be people of more. In your name, we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were sinners, so that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Amen. Amen. And now that we are forgiven children of God, let us extend peace and love to one another at this time. Just give someone a wave, a smile. Amen. As we prepare for the offering, we'll begin with the mission moment. And following that, we'll have our morning offering.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Just 3 months ago in June, United Women in Faith presented two scholarships, one to Jasmine and one to Ruby. These were scholarships funded by the Harriet Strong Wright Scholarship, which was established in 2003 in memory of Miss Wright, a woman of strong faith and a creative educator. So this morning, as I stand here, first of all, I want to say thank you to the congregation. As you see on the screen, we have awarded 31 scholarships for a total amount of $17,500, which we, that deserves a hand. Which we would not have been able to do had you not supported us in this mission. And today, when you entered, you received this little envelope with the weeping willow on it, because we hope that you will continue to support our scholarship fund so that in years to come, we can award a scholarship to Jewel, to Isaac, to Malcolm, to Lachelle, and we'll be able to do that with your continued support of our scholarship fund. Make your check payable to New Creation UMW. Even though we're now United Women in Faith, our checking account still says UMW. So make your check payable to New Creation UMW. And we'll be so appreciative of your support of our scholarship fund. Thank you very much.
So we ask our ushers if you would come, and we'll receive both the Harriet Scholarship offering and also your regular offering. If you would just lift your offering, they'll receive it.
Thank you.
us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for these gifts that you have given us. And God, as we offer these gifts back to you, we also offer ourselves, and that together we might transform this weeping world into a place of peace and grace. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. The Lord be with you. We lift up our hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God. You created heaven and earth. You made us into your image and breathed into us the breath of life. And when our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You are our healing balm. You turned our mourning into dancing, our sorrow into joy, our weeping into laughter. And in you there is salvation, deliverance, and restoration. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. You are holy, you are faithful and just, and we praise your name. Blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life as a ransom for all. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, free the oppressed, and announce that the time had come when you would save your people. By the baptism of Jesus' suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made a new covenant with us by the water and the Spirit. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you. He broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which was given for you." And likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks to you, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you, in remembrance of me. For this is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Amen.
pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine, and make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we all feast together at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory and power is yours now and forever. Now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses. Amen. The bread and the cup was given for you. So I invite you now, my sisters and my brothers, to take and eat and be thankful. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, amen. Let us stand for closing hymn. Thank you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is it well with your soul this morning? Hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm just going to ask you to indulge me for a moment. If you will play that refrain just one more time and let us sing to the glory of God, if it is well with your soul. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on and let's praise him. Thank you, Lord. And now go forth in peace. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.